the Lord's laid on our heart. And I prayed for God to give me a message for mothers. I prayed and prayed. I kept praying, God, give me a message for mothers. Mother's Day. People expect to hear a message about mothers. And then I realized finally I was praying the wrong way. I was praying for my will, and that's not what God wanted. And finally I said, God, you give me the message you want preached. And he did. And I'm sorry it's not about mothers this morning, but it is about a topic that each one of us need to know about, and that is being out of God's will. If you have your copy of God's Word and are able to stand, if you'll stand with me for the reading of God's Word, Mark 16, we're going to read the first seven verses. The Gospel of Mark, chapter 16. And here the Bible says, "And when the Sabbath was passed, Mary Magdalene and Mary the mother of James and Salome had bought sweet spices that they might come and anoint him. Very early in the morning, the first day of the week, they came unto the sepulchre at the rising of the sun. And they said among themselves, Who shall roll us away the stone from the door of the sepulchre? And when they looked, they saw that the stone was rolled away, for it was very great. And entering into the sepulchre, they saw a young man sitting on the right side, clothed in a long white garment, and they were affrighted. And he saith unto them, Be not affrighted, you seek Jesus of Nazareth, which was crucified. He is risen, he is not here. Behold the place where they laid him. But go your way, tell his disciples and Peter that he goeth before you into Galilee. There shall you see him as he said unto you." Let's pray. Father, thank you so much for the reading of your word this morning. God, we're thankful for the good, sweet spirit we felt this morning. Lord, for the tears that we know come from above. Lord, we're just praying for each person that's in this congregation, God, that they receive the word the way you have them do, God. And that takes opening of our hearts this morning, Lord, and for our minds, Lord, and to focus on you and your word, Lord, and your spirit, not the things of the world. And God, we're praying for your help today. Preach for us, God. We're a miserable preacher, Lord, but with you we can do it. And God, we're just asking for your help today. For it's these things I ask in Jesus' name. Amen. You can be seated. Well, as we come to this last chapter of the Gospel of Mark, it denotes a time that all the Gospels speak of. It speaks of this in all four of them. They mention this account. However, this is the only Gospel that mentions one particular thing that we read. If you go back, if you mark things in your Bible, I want you to look at verse 7 of Mark 16. And I want you to look, pay close attention to that, where the Bible says, "But go your way, tell his disciples and Peter that he goeth before you into Galilee." I noticed from reading all the accounts of the gospel that this is the only one that brings out the name Peter when the women are told to go and tell that Jesus is risen. The other gospels do not include that. Matthew says, go tell the disciples. The others doesn't say it at all. But there's nothing in there else except for in Mark where he specifies specifically to tell Peter. Now, while this may not seem like much to the casual reader, if you're a gospel, if you're in the Bible and you read your Bible and you hold it near and dear to your heart, you understand that God puts things in there for us that are these little nuggets, that he puts them in there for us to capture and get a hold of, and to understand that he's put that there for a specific reason and purpose. It's not a mistake that it's in there. And by the way, friends, there's not a mistake in this Bible. Amen. And I don't care who tries to tell you there's a mistake in our Bible. There is not a mistake. It is perfect. It's infallible. It's the perfect Word of God. Everything in here is God's Word. It's not man's Word. It was written down by man's hand, but it was completely inspired by God. And every word in here is perfect and true. Let's keep that in our thoughts this morning. And it says, go your way and tell the disciples and Peter. Now, I have several favorite Bible characters throughout there. And most of you know that probably the Apostle Paul, besides Jesus, is probably one of my most favorite Bible heroes. I don't really like to call them characters. I like to call them heroes. Because they're heroes of the faith. But I have many of them. The Apostle Paul, of course, being up there at the top. John the Baptist. Boy, if I could just go back and live in that time period where John the Baptist lived and watch him preaching out there in the wilderness. And then there's other of my heroes in there, Elijah. How I'd love to see him call down fire from the heavens and consume the sacrifice of all those wicked prophets of Baal. How I would love to go back and see some of these things these great men of God have done, like Moses and Abraham. How he led the children out of bondage and things that Moses did. And how Abraham followed God and went where God told him to, not going where he was going. I have many of these heroes in the Bible. But as I look at this one today, and this name mentioned the Apostle Peter, he was one of the disciples, one of the very first disciples that was called by Jesus to follow him. In fact, he was one of the little inner circle, as Peter, James, and John we see mentioned many times, all together as being around Jesus through his earthly ministry. And I can look at the Apostle Peter, and I can see the things in his life, and I can identify with him. I believe out of all the disciples, I can identify with Peter more than anybody else in the entire Bible. And if you think about it for a minute, it may be the one that you identify with the most as well. I mean, here we see Peter. At one minute, he's stepping off of a boat into the middle of the water, and he's walking on top of the water, and everything's going great. The next minute, he's sinking. His faith is wavering. He looks down. He looks out. He sees the wind. Boisterous starts sinking. Friends, isn't that like us? I mean, one minute we're on the mountaintop, the next we're down in the valley. And it don't take but a split second. And all that happened within just a few verses of each other. And I see other things that happen in Peter's life. He's standing there outside of the garden where Jesus has been praying all night in agony. And he's been over here sleeping. But when they get up and the soldiers come to take Jesus, Peter is standing there boldly with a sword trying to hack off somebody's ear. I believe he was aiming for the head and missed and got the ear. But he was no swordsman, but he whacked off this soldier's ear. And then, and within that same text, if you read your Bible, that same exact chapter, just a few verses down, Peter is cowering. He's hovering around a fire with the other sinner in the world. And he's denying and he's cursing the name of Jesus. Friends, I want you to know that one minute Peter is a hero, and the next minute he is a complete zero. And when I look at Peter's life, I can say, Brother Byron, that is you. That's you right there. I mean, I can just see it all happening. So let's take our minds back to this point in our text. Right before this, what had happened? Well, of course, we know the story. Peter denies Christ, and that old cock crows three times, how he goes off in shame. And how Peter's ministry now looks like it's got a blemish upon it. It looks like it's ended. I could see Peter sitting in this room with the other disciples. And they were in a room together. I could see Peter sitting there, probably in a corner by himself. And how he must have been so depressed. What have I done? What have I done to the Lord? He was my best friend. He did everything for me. And how could I deny him? I can see Peter sitting there in that room, feeling so low and so down and so rejected. And then all of a sudden that door burst open. Here comes Mary and those other women. And they're saying, you're never going to believe this. Jesus is risen. And he said to come and tell you. I could just see that whole room as they become jubilant. And how much joy they must have in their heart. And how excited they are. As they all jump up and they want to see Jesus. But I can see Peter sitting over there. You mean everybody but me, right? You mean everybody but me, because I've lost my ministry. I'm not even counted a disciple anymore because I deny him. I can see that. I can see Peter. I can just feel what he would feel as he'd done that. And how he must have thought, oh, for everybody but me. And then can't you just see him? As Mary says, no. Hey, Peter. He specifically said, tell Peter. He didn't mention anybody else's name, but he said, you tell Peter. You tell Peter. You tell Peter. Oh, and how Peter must have got such joy. How that must have come from within him as he ran. The Bible tells us that he ran and he went to the tomb to see. Oh, friends, I can just see this taking place. Now, as I look at this witness that Peter had and the things that he went through and what possibly might have happened there as he found out about Jesus coming back and living again, and I start thinking about us today. I start thinking about Christians. Peter was Christian. Peter walked the Christian walk most of the time. But then I started thinking about being out of God's will. clearly that's where Peter was. And then I found some things, and I want you to, if you write down things, I'll give you five things this morning. These are five reasons that we are out of God's will. And this won't be long. Number one, you have not gone deep enough with God. You've not gone deep enough with Him. One of the saddest things to me is to see a Christian that has not gone deep enough with God. I mean, they're not there. They're not planted. Oh, they still have their name on the church roll. They identify themselves as a Christian. They take that name, you know, as a Christian. But yet they don't live the life. They don't walk the walk. And let me tell you why. They have not went deep enough. Now, I've told you this before, but growing up, we planted. I mean, my dad planted gardens all summer. My grandfather, Lauren, planted. And there I was with both of them. Every time planting season, I was there. And every time they would plow those roads, Lauren would be behind that old mule, hollering at them commands, gee-haw, get around there. And he'd plow them roads down through there, and they'd be about that big. And as they would hand me the seed, I would carry it in a bucket or the thing around my waist, and I would have seed. They'd let me help sometimes. And we'd come down through there, and you know what? Both my grandfather and my dad both said to me, plant those ankle deep. Ankle deep. And we would throw those seed in that ditch that had been plowed, and it'd be ankle deep, just deep enough, about up to your ankle. Well, let me tell you the reason you do that. As you plant a seed ankle deep and you cover it up with dirt, that seed, when it starts getting water and the sun starts shining down and the roots start forming and they start looking for nutrients and those roots start spreading out and they go lower, deeper than ankle deep. And they start finding things to live and survive. The next thing you know, they're growing and they're raising up and coming above the surface. And so they are getting all these things, these nutrients that they need to be able to live. Now, sadly, a lot of Christians today, they profess Christ as their Savior. Perhaps they were saved. Perhaps they did actually get saved. But then they only keep their relationship with Christ about ankle deep. They never go any deeper. They're just as shallow as they were when they began. And the next thing you know, what happens to a seed that don't grow, that the roots don't take place? Well, that plant either doesn't grow at all, or it'll grow up about this high and fall over, or something will take it over because it don't have the life within it to be able to survive. And that's the Christian today that's no more than ankle deep. They're too shallow with their walk with Christ, and they can't survive. But I want you to know that Psalm 1:1 says, "Blessed is the man who walketh not in the counsel of the ungodly, nor standeth in the way of sinners, nor sitteth in the seat of the scornful. But his delight is in the law of the Lord, and his law doth he meditate day and night." Verse 3, get this. "And he shall be like a tree planted by the rivers of water, that bringeth forth his fruit in his season. His leaf also shall not wither, and whatsoever he doeth shall prosper." Friends, that's Bible right there. That's not me, that's Bible. That is what the Lord expects for his people to be like that tree planted by the water. And by the way, if you've ever seen a tree over by the water, they sit over here at Roseberry Creek across from Mom and Dad's place, and those roots got down, and those roots have a system on them. I mean, it looks like miles you see these roots. There's a tree down there you can't get your arms around that's right by that creek. And friends, I want to tell you what, that's the way Christians need to be. We need to be more than just ankle deep. We need to get our roots down in that ground. We need to grow. We need to prosper and come up in the Lord and be the Christian and walk the walk that He would have us walk and not be shallow. Friends, too many people have not gone deep enough with God. Number two, the reason for being out of God's will, you have been disobedient to the call of God in your life. You've been disobedient to the call of God in your life. Now you may remember a prophet named Jonah. We won't tell the whole story, but you know it from Sunday school. Oh, Jonah was a prophet of God. God said, "Go down to Nineveh and tell the people that they got to repent of their wicked ways, or else I'm going to destroy them." What did Jonah do? "I hate those people. I don't want to do it. I'm not doing it." And he went the opposite way. What become of Jonah? Misery, heartache, uncertainty. As he was swallowed up in the belly of that fish, the whale, even the New Testament says the whale, as he was swallowed up there,
And then he finally, he submitted to God's will. He went to Nineveh and he preached the word. The people repented. He still got upset. But the people repented and God did not destroy them that time. I want you to know, because Jonah was not being obedient to God's will, his whole life fell apart. You see all the things that happened to him. I want you to know there are people today that are saved that God has called them to do a job. That he's called them, it may not be a preacher. It may not be a missionary. It might be a Sunday school teacher. It might be a song leader. It might be somebody just to stay in the choir and sing. It may be your job to be the prayer warrior. It may be your job to visit the sick. It may be your job to go out in the community and spread the gospel. It may be your job to be the director of missions. It may be your job to drive that van over here under this shed. It might be your job to play that guitar that's got dust on it. It may be your job to tickle the ivories on this organ right here that's being left unplayed. It may be your job to do any of these things, but you're not being obedient to God's will for your life, and it's bringing you down. You can't be in His will as long as you're not doing what He wants you to do. Friends, I want you to know today that you must accept God's will. If you want to see a happiness and joy, and you want to have the walk that you need to have with the Lord, you will do His will. There is peace and there's power in doing God's will and by living an obedient life. My Uncle Ronnie said to me, and you know him well now, he's took you out all over the place. My Uncle Ronnie said to me one day, he said, Byron, I was talking to him about the choir and how I needed a song leader and things. He said, Byron, I want to tell you something. He said, God is more interested in your obedience than He is your comfort. I'll never forget that. Those words of wisdom. Friends, that's what God is interested in today. He's interested in your obedience. That's what He expects of us. If you've been saved today, if you've been bought by the blood of Jesus, if you've accepted Him as your Savior, He expects your obedience. Why are we not being obedient? Because we're out of His will. We're out of His spirit. Friends, we must be in God's will. Third reason for being out of God's will, you may have been hurt by trouble or sorrow. How many people today, I'm not going to ask you to raise your hand, but could raise your hand. I've been hurt, Brother Byron. Somebody's hurt me, or there's been something happened in my life that has hurt me and has caused me sorrow and trouble and brought me down. And it's drawing me away from God. It's getting me, I'm not close enough because of that. Now, you would think trouble and sorrow would bring you closer to God, wouldn't you? I mean, that's the obvious place to go, isn't it? Why on earth do people, Christians, go somewhere else to look for something for their troubles? Why on earth would you consult some man, some psychiatrist, some pill, some self-help book, some Oprah Winfrey character on TV? Why would you consult somebody like that when you have the God of heaven and the God of earth that can help you? I want you to know that too many people are being hurt and they got troubles and they're going to the wrong place to look for help. What happens because of this? Well, I want to tell you a story, and this is going to break some hearts here today. It's going to break mine. But I want you to know, if you go back to 2001 of September, as my family was sitting out on the patio up front of my parents' house, we were having a cookout. It's the only first one we had that year. We always had a cookout every year. Oh, we had the fire going, the marshmallows, and the hot chocolate, the hamburgers, the hot dogs, all the good stuff. My sister was sitting there in her usual place, and she wasn't eating. And I come and I said, man, what's the matter? She sighs. I don't feel like it. I don't feel good. And I just kind of, made fun of her and said, oh, come on, eat something. I just didn't think much about it. That next week, she fell. She had to be taken to the doctor. She was diagnosed with leukemia that next week. I want you to know, for the next year, she lived in total misery. Her life was horrible. She went down to Vanderbilt, had the bone marrow transplant. It rejected. She caught all these problems from it, host versus graft disease, whatever that is. She couldn't eat. She lost half of her body weight. She lost her hair. She lost everything. She was miserable for a year. For a year. My family was in pain over this. I mean, it was awful. I could see my parents aging through the process. All the things that happened.
Within a year and 2 months, on December 16, 2002, my mom called me and said, come to the hospital. And I went, and it was too late. It was gone. And I walked back to the emergency room, and there was my parents standing there. There was a doctor, and he was explaining, and he was telling all the reasons and all this. I saw how hard it was on my parents and family. But I want you to know, through that struggle, through that trouble, through that sorrow, I never saw them give up on God. I never saw them say, let's just not go to church. I never saw them say, let's just quit teaching in Sunday school. I never saw my mom say, I'm just going to quit singing. I'm just not going to sing anymore. I never saw any of that. You know what I saw? I saw them continue on. I saw them staying close to God. I saw them back in church. I saw them teaching the Sunday school classes and singing in the choir and singing specials. I saw them following God's will for their life. They were being obedient. They never wavered through all that. Not that I know of. Not that I didn't ever see it. I want you to know, this past April, April the 22nd, my sister would have been 50 years old. And when that week rolled around, I knew it was going to be hard on my mom. She was here. She was here. She was staying obedient. Listen to what the Bible says in Matthew 11 and 28. Jesus says, come unto me, all you that labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn of me, for I am meek and lowly in heart, and you shall find rest of your souls. For my yoke is easy, and my burden is light. Why on earth would you go anywhere else? Why would you turn your back on God when you're going through sorrow and trouble? I know people that are doing that today. They've lost family members. They've lost people in their life. And they're bitter. And they don't want to go on. And they turn their back on God. Friends, we can't be that way. We've got to stay in God's will. Fourth, reason for being out of God's will, you have neglected your Christian duties. You've neglected them. Oh, once you were a regular in church. You were one of those used-to-be's. Just like old Demas that used to be on fire for God. That used to be walking with Paul. But Demas forsook Paul for the world. Oh, you used to be a church member. You used to be faithful. You used to be loyal. You gave tithes. You gave your offerings. You gave. You were a giver. But then something came between you and the Lord. I don't know what it was. I'm reminded of a woman named Naomi. If you go back to the book of Ruth, and I'm not going to tell the whole story. There was Naomi, and she lost her husband and her sons, left with two daughter-in-laws, nothing else, Ruth and Orpah. She was destitute. There was a famine. She needed to eat. She needed help. She decided to go back to her home in Bethlehem, where she was from. And as she went, she told them they could just leave. Orpah did. She left. Not Ruth. Ruth stayed with her. They went back to Bethlehem, and as she entered into that city, you know what all the people said? Is that Naomi? And by the way, Naomi, the name means pleasant, pleasant, pleasantness. And she looked at them and she said, don't you call me that. I'm not Naomi, I'm not pleasant. But call me Mara because I'm bitter, because God has dealt bitterly with me. I'm bitter. He's done things. Call me Mara. And as she went through and she started looking more toward God, she started looking to God's will for even her daughter-in-law's life, and everything started coming together. And I want you to know, by the end of that book of Ruth, there in chapter 4, there's only four chapters, and in the end of it, we see that people are coming and saying that Naomi is blessed by the Lord. He had restored all these things to her. She was now blessed, and she even became an heir to the throne of King David. I want you to know, if we're being God's will, we need to keep on with our Christian duties. Keep on. You can't find joy without being in His will. You can't do it. John 16 and 24 says, hitherto have you asked nothing in my name. Ask and you shall receive, that your joy may be full. Friends, the Lord wants you to be joyful. And He wants you to be joyful in Him. How do you do that? You live with Him. You be obedient to Him. You do your Christian duty. Fifth and final thing. reason for being out of God's will, you've let some secret sin creep in your life. You've let some secret sin creep in. Now, many of you all have made comments here recently about my hair turning gray. I got a lot of gray hair in here now. I want you to know that that didn't happen overnight. It's been a process. It started, I don't know, probably 2 years ago. Started plugging them out. They say not to do that because two have grown its place, and it does. And it didn't happen overnight. It took a process. You know, sin is the same exact way. Now, you may fall into sin all at once and just go gung-ho after it. But I want you to know that sin usually is a process. You allow something in your life. You start petting that little sin. And you start trying to see how close you can get to that sin and still be trying to hang on back here to God and to His will. You can't do that. I want you to know that sin is a process. You start getting into it, and then you get deeper and deeper. And then before you know it, it's fully taken you. That sin is in your life, and you can't control it. I want you to know that I don't believe there's been anybody that ever woke up one morning and said, you know what? I'm going to start being a drug addict. That's my goal in life. I'm going to be a drug addict. Give me some drugs. Somebody pump me up. How many people do you know that's ever done that? No. You know what they did? They started out with something little. Oh, here, this won't hurt you. It's make you feel good. Take this little pill. Puff this little joint right here. Do this and do that. And before you know it, you're fully addicted. Friends, I've got family members that are addicted to drugs. I mean, it's got a grasp on them, a hold on them that won't let go. It will happen to you in a heartbeat, that little sin. And it's a process. Don't ever begin it. Young people, don't you ever begin to take anything. I don't care if your best friend in school says, oh, it won't hurt you. I know so-and-so that does it. I've done it. Don't you ever do it. It'll be your downfall. You mark my word. You mark it right here, right now. It will bring you down. Don't you ever try. If they ever say, oh, that preacher's crazy, you tell them to come to me and talk to me. I'll give them a little Bible. I want you to know that sin will take over your life. I also don't know of anybody that ever woke up and said, I think I'd like to be a wino. I think I'd like to be a drunk. I think I'd like to lay around on the sidewalk homeless and bum for money. How many people do you know that's ever done that? None. You know what? They started out, oh, here, try this right here. It's a wine cooler. It tastes like Cuba. Drink it. Huh? Try this Boone's Farm. It just tastes like Kool-Aid. Next thing you know, you're trying a little something harder. Try this Jack Daniels. Put it in your Coke. You won't even know it's there. Friends, that's how it starts. It's a process. The next thing you know, you're a drunk. The next thing you know, you've lost your family. The next thing you know, you're using every penny that you have. You're selling your possessions. You're going down to the places and selling off everything you got. The pawn shop. You're going down to the super pawn. Pawning off your stereos, your car, your CD players and things, your guitars and all that. Why? To get a little bit of money so you can get another bottle. And yet sin has brought you down. Friends, there's people that are Christians today that are in that position. Not practicing Christians, but Christians. I want you to know that sin will get between you and God. And friends, it'll get a grip on you and you're completely out of His will. This happens over time. I remember as a child, again, going back to my garden days. And there beside Lauren's house, most of you know where he lived out there on the road. He's got that garden over there beside. Well, he had all these tires lined up down there. I think Chester gave him when he had the tire shop. He had all these tires lined up down there. And inside the tires, he was growing things. He grew strawberries and potatoes. And I was walking out there with him one day, and boy, the strawberries, I mean, they were green, they were huge, they were ripe and red. And I was talking to him, I said, how in the world does this work? You know what he said? Manure. Yeah, shocker, huh? I want you to know that the Christian today, we are going to walk in the filth of this world, but we don't have to be part of it. Those strawberries might have been planted in some filth, but I want you to know they rose above it. They come up and they grew and they become beautiful and ripe and delicious, and they become what they were supposed to be. They rose up out of the muck and out of the mire and out of the field, and they become something good. Friends, that's what the Christian has to do today. You cannot be part of this world.
We may be in it, but we are not of it. Friends, we're a separated person. If you're a Christian today, you are separated. And I don't care what this flim-flam place down the road tries to tell you. I don't care what this modern thinking tries to tell you, that you can still live like the world and be part of God's people. You can't. That's not part of it. That's not how it works. We're a separated people. Romans 8 and 6, and I'm almost done. It says, for to be carnally minded is death, but to be spiritually minded is life and peace. Because the carnal mind is enmity against God. For it's not subject to the law of God, neither indeed can be. So then they that are in the flesh cannot please God. You can't please God and be in the flesh. The Bible says so right there. Out of God's will. There is hope. Psalm 143 and 10. The psalmist David, if anybody knew about struggles and sin, it was him. He said, teach me to do thy will, for thou art my God. Thy spirit is good. Lead me in the land of brightness. Friends, if you're struggling with some problem, some sin, get down to the Lord. Bow on your knees and ask Him to help you. He'll help you. So what's our five things? Being out of the will, God's will. You've not went deep enough with Him. Number two, you're not being obedient to Him. Number three, you've been hurt by some trouble or sorrow, some death, some problem that's happened. Four, you've neglected your Christian duties. You're not doing what God wants you to do. Fifth, there's some secret sin that's harboring your walk with Christ. Some sin in your life. If Charlotte comes to play the piano this morning, I want to ask you to listen to me closely. Don't stop now. Don't give up now. Don't quit listening to me right now. I don't care if you've ignored me this whole time. I want you to listen to me right now. Right now. As she plays something. Play just as I am. Play that. Play JK2. 81 something. I want you to know today that being out of God's will, you can't have joy. You can't have the real joy that God can give you. I want you to know that all these things I've listed, these are just a few. There's many others. I could have kept you here another hour going on. These are a few things. But I want you to know, if you don't take care of these problems in your life, your walk with God is going to be diminished. You're not in His will. You're not going to have joy. There may be somebody here like that today. Maybe one of these has hit you personally. Maybe I've stepped on your toes just a little bit this morning. If I have, I want you to pray this morning. I want you to ask the Lord to help you. I want you to ask Him. You might be sitting here this morning and you don't have a clue what I'm talking about because you've never been saved. Joy of having Christ in your life. Friends, there is a joy. It's a peace that passes all understanding. It's something that He gives you that the world can't even describe, can't give you from nothing. No drug, no alcohol, no physical relationship, none of those things can even come close to what God can do for you. If you've not known that joy, if He's been dealing with your heart this morning, I want you to pray. As we stand this morning, I want you to pray with me. And if any of these things, if God's talking to you this morning, I want to ask you to come to this altar and let's pray with you. We're not here to be seen by men or put on any kind of show. This is real. These are things, friends, you've got to make a decision. You're either going to live for God or you're not. That decision lies upon your shoulders. Nobody else can do it for you. That person beside you, they got nothing to do with your relationship with Christ. It's you. It's between you and Him. Let's bow our head and close our eyes. If anybody has a need, you come to this altar this morning. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we ask you this morning, Lord, to deal with hearts and minds, God. If there's one in here today that's struggling with some problem, God, no matter what it may be, God, maybe they've got sorrow. Maybe they've got trouble. Maybe they've got something going on in their life, God, that is just overwhelmed them and they can't get over it. God, they need help this morning. God, if there's one in here today, Lord, I pray that you have them. Come down to this altar, Lord. Let's pray with them, Lord, and get their life to where it needs to be. God, they may be backslidden Christians today, Lord, that need to follow up, Lord, and come back, Lord, to you and just get that close walk again, Lord, to rededicate their life to you. God, is there one here today? God, I'm urging you today for the Holy Spirit, Lord. May it just fill this room, God. Is there one? Is there one?